On March 7th, 1974, actress Lucille Ball was a sole guest on The Dick Cavett Show. The last thing she revealed about herself was a story which to this day remains hard to believe. It goes back to 1942 in California when she had some temporary tooth fillings done. These fillings were apparently able to pick up radio signals and play music inside her teeth. And not only that, these same fillings also picked up Morse code coming from Japanese spies in an underground hideout. This story makes Lucille Ball a crucial player in the American fight against the Axis powers formed by Nazi Germany, Fascist Italy, and Imperial Japan. Only there's a problem. There's absolutely no mention of the story in Lucille Ball's FBI file, which contains numerous other accounts of her involvement in political situations. Does this make her story false? Not necessarily. In 2003, the Mythbusters took up the challenge of turning teeth from a human corpse into radio receivers. Their conclusion was that it's not possible to turn dental fillings into radio receivers. Does this make Lucille Ball's story false? Maybe. You see, many of the conditions under which the Mythbusters conducted their experiments weren't reliable simulations of what happens inside a living person's mouth. Most importantly, you just can't make an identical replica of an individual's mouth, specifically their teeth, especially if you don't have access to their dental records. That's one of the reasons for which forensic dentists are called for help when identifying a cadaver which is either badly decomposed or burnt to a crisp. Their hard tissues essentially become their fingerprint chart. Does this make Lucille Ball's story true? Let's step away from dental fillings for a moment, okay? I recently went down to the Health Sciences Library at the University of Montreal and found a 1981 article about a man who picked up radio signals through shrapnel fragments lodged inside his skull. This man, named Mr. A by the author, had basically become a walking radio made out of metal and flesh. It's still not understood exactly how the shrapnel picked up the signals, but the main hypothesis is that the bits of metal acted as what's called a rectifier inside a radio receiver. Let's back up and see how a signal is sent outwards from a broadcasting station. A transmitter inside the station takes care of translating sound waves into radio waves. Variations in sound waves can either be coded into slight variations of the amplitude of the radio waves or of their frequency, depending on the broadcasting mode of the station. These radio waves are then emitted in the surrounding space by powerful antennas. Like these four huge antennas belonging to CJAD Montreal. 50,000 watts of raw AM radio power. On the receiving end of the signals, another antenna picks up the radio waves and the radio receiver translates them back into sound. Linus Sebastian from TechQuickie has a great video explaining in detail but in simple terms how the process of radio transmission works. But for the purpose of this video, here's what you need to know. The most simple radio receiver you can imagine only needs three parts: an antenna, a detector, and a speaker. The antenna picks up the radio waves and transforms them into electrical current. The detector transforms that electrical current to create a bridge between the realm of radio waves and sound waves. And the speaker takes that electrical current from the detector and transforms it into physical vibrations, thus producing sound. In the case of Mr. A, the antenna part was played by his body, more specifically the fluid inside his head, the shrapnel acted as a detector, and the speaker was equally played by the shrapnel, which vibrated inside the skull, transmitted that sounds inside the ear. And this is the only article in scientific literature about a human being having become a radio receiver. This same article points to a 1959 case of a woman claiming to pick up signals through her silver tooth fillings. The cat's out of the bag, right? Not quite. The editor's conclusion is essentially a passive-aggressive suggestion to have her evaluated by a psychiatrist. And what would the psychiatric diagnosis of this patient's complaints be? Auditory hallucinations, or parakushas, are perceptions of sound happening without any physical stimulation of the ears or of the nerves. These sounds can either be voices or music or a loud bang like a gunshot in cases of exploding head syndrome. So, there definitely exist conditions where the sounds are only perceived inside the mind without having any physical explanations. Does this mean that Lucille Ball maybe was telling a lie? The point isn't to find out if she was telling the truth, or if she was telling a lie, or if she was hallucinating, or whatever. The point is that no matter what your beliefs may be, you need to have your claims verified by other people within an environment that's as objective as humanly possible. And even when that's accomplished, nobody can claim to hold the absolute and definitive truth, but rather a more effective model of explaining how the world seems to function around us. Some people call that science. I call that being more effective in handing future generations a head start in their development. Cheers to that.